what are the features of lymph nodes in on ultrasound on in lymphoma?
In malignancy.
Lymphoma.
Okay. Sir.
Metastatic nodes are slightly different. So lymphoma.
Sir, in lymphoma, the lymph nodes will be smooth, regular, and hard nodes with...
Hard is clinical finding. Yeah. Ultrasound.
Sir,
I was not even doing it, so you wanted to do it. That's why I'm asking you now. Doing ultrasound in all cases is useful. Yes. It can guide you. But if there is a lymph node waiting to be tested, FNA, tuberculosis, ATT start, every day it happens in your OPD, doesn't it? I've been to your college.
Hmm.
At our place, the same thing. You won't be going in circles there. Today you go for ultrasound and you know you find out type of, oh, he's gone. So you will do what you do. That's what they are asking. No, there's no rocket science here. Clear?
Yes,
the answer to the exam is to do... FNAC from the lymph nodes, preferably under ultrasound guidance, so that you can find their nature also. Mm-hmm. You won't have collection here, but if there is a cold abscess, then of course, cold abscess is a cold abscess.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't need too many, you know, investigations. You know, you do anti-gravity aspiration and you move on. Even that doesn't need an ultrasound so regularly. So everybody will ask you this question. I have no problem with ultrasound because I think it's an extension of clinical examination only. The ultrasound features of lymphoma are slightly different from metastatic nodes. It won't have the characteristics of a metastatic node. What are the characteristics of a metastatic node?
There will be loss of the usual reniform pattern. There will be loss of central halo. And there will be the ecotexture will be altered.
Here it is smooth. And the increased vascularity at the hilum is the only thing you look at. And the halo is preserved. The halo around.
Mm.
You know, because there is no peritonitis. Unless the peritonitis happens, they don't get stuck.
Mm.
Hodgkin's, you have lymphomas, you have discrete nodes, no? In malignancy, they tend to go out of the capsule commonly. So therefore, the halo sign is very important here. Okay,
mm-hmm.
That's for lymphoma. But you've done an FNAC, it is tuberculosis. What do you do?
If it has come out to be tuberculosis, then I will like to see if the patient was previously treated or it's a new case. Then I will start my anti-tubercular medication.
You have given the, you provided the history. There's no such thing. No? Hmm.
So for this case, I will... like to start a category 1 regimen for this patient, and for this the regimen is 2 months of HRZDE followed by 5 months of HRE.
Correct. Now the other side, FNAC reveals nothing and you have a suspicion of lymphoma. You need to take a biopsy. Now you show the picture, which node you will remove?
Sir, in this patient, the posterior group of lymph nodes was removed.
This is a scar there already? It was removed, there is a node already there.
Still. Yeah, but it has recurred, sir. They have removed and it was removed.
So usually it's the posterior triangle nodes that you remove, okay. You want to ask something? Sumit?
Actually, you said ki it is excisional biopsy done only 10 days back.
Yes, sir.
So there is a recurrence in 10 days.
So actually, it was not done by us, so we don't know what exactly amount they removed.
There will be another one. They cook couple of them they pick up. And don't be too fussy and rigid on not matted and look for it carefully because you're not examining. Often we find that this is a goofed up scenario. So don't make a lymphoma out of nowhere. If it is lymphoma, there's nothing to hide. You can, and as Dr. Ratna was saying, the pattern of nodes similar all around, because in tuberculosis you find them in different stages. One is soft, the other is becoming soft in the process, so the matting also takes a little while. You've taken a biopsy, and why do you need a biopsy for lymphoma?
We need a biopsy for lymphoma because we need a immunohistochemistry for...
First thing is immunohistochemistry or something else?
First is a confirmation of the diagnosis
Histology, no? You need the histology.
Yes.
Why is histology important in making a diagnosis?
So because this lymphoelectrical malignancy, these are always a histopathological diagnosis.
Why? It is based on something, no? Why FNAC cannot tell you the diagnosis?
the type of cells,
yes,
and the very specific presence of Reed-Sternberg or popcorn type of cells.
You need to see all this in the tissue. In an FNA, you may not be able to get any information that you're looking for, which will make it into a lymphoma. Except atypical cells, you will not see anything else. What are Reed-Sternberg cells?
Reed-Sternberg cells, these are typically found in lymphomas. These are a large cell with a bilobed mirror imaging nucleus. And
they are also giant cells, no?
Giant cells.
Okay, any more? You find it's lymphoma, how do you proceed? Which type is likely in 25 years?
In 25 years old, I will like to think about Hodgkin lymphoma as it has a bimodal peak at a younger age, 15 to 25 years, and after that, 40 to 50 years.
That's correct. What extra examination you would like to do carefully now? You think it is Hodgkin's?
So after I have my histopathological diagnosis,
you mentioned about immunohistochemistry. What is it that you're looking for?
So in immunohistochemistry, I will like to see for CD markers.
Yes.
Like in this case, if it's a Hodgkin, I will have CD30 and CD15 positive.
That's correct.
And after that, after confirmation of diagnosis, I will like to then stage my disease for management of my treatment. And for staging the disease as per NCCN guidelines, I will like to go for a CT scan of thorax and abdomen and find out the nodes in relation to the diaphragm and stage according to the...
How do you stage it? Based on CT? You're right, NCCN guidelines say you have to do CT for it. We don't do these days staging laparotomies and laparoscopies. Yes, you can do with CT, good CTs, that is it, okay.
So I will stage according the Cotswold modification of the Ann Arbor staging. So it is divided. It is classified as stage 1, where there is involvement of a single group of lymph node or a single extra lymphatic site. Stage 2 is two or more sites on the same side of the diaphragm. Stage 3 is when the lymph nodes are present on the both sides of the diaphragm with a local extra lymphatic nodal involvement. And stage 4 is disseminated disease with a...
Give her a big round of applause for that. It's correctly answered. How do you proceed? You've done the staging. It is intra. It is just confined. In this case, there are lymph nodes all over the place, but there's no visceral involvement. Right? You've described it also, and we found the same thing. How do you proceed, and how do you manage?
Sir, also further classification will be based on the A symptoms and the B symptoms. And A symptoms is include A stage. This includes no systemic manifestations, and B this includes night.
Which system we are talking about?
Sir. Like after staging the disease, we will also look for A and B group of symptoms.
Which systems you're talking about? Which systems are involved? In addition to the lymphatic, which other systems you'd look for?
In lymphoma, sir, systems.
Which other organs will have the reticular system that you would like to include?
Sir, I would like to look in the liver,
yes,
spleen.
Yes.
And...
And of course, how about bone marrows?
And bone marrow.
So that's why I'm asking. Yes. Don't forget that. That's a part of it. So how do you proceed? I stopped you, but that was a question which was on because you didn't mention that. Okay.
So after putting the patient in A category or B category, A, this includes no systemic symptoms. B, this includes night sweats, fever with a weight loss of more than 10% in less than 6 months. And as it's a disseminated disease, that like stage 3 and stage 4 disease, I will like to go for chemotherapy and associated with intensive focused radiotherapy. And for chemotherapy, I will like to give ABVD regimen, adriamycin, bleomycin, vincristine, and dacarbazine, and 4 cycles. And after that, I will like to give extended there's a radiotherapy. And this will be in higher, 30 to 40 grays. And after that, I will restage my disease after completion of chemotherapy with a PET setting.
Okay. Now, any role of targeted therapy in Hodgkin's?
Sir, first line of management is chemotherapy.
I agree. What is R-CHOP regime? R-CHOP, whatever.
CHOP regimen is cyclophosphamide hydroxy.
Is it because they are prompting you getting confused or?
cyclophosphamide, hydroxy, adriamycin, I don't remember, and oncovin and prednisolone.
And what is that R here? Rituximab.
Rituximab, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Any more questions? Any question? Generalized lymphadenopathy is a very, very common case in the exam. Now, once you've done the therapy, you said we'll assess for, we'll restage. In restaging, you use PET scan. That's what you said?
Yes, sir.
But if you've not used it in the initial staging, would the PET scan be useful?
Yes, sir. PET scan will show us the remnant focus of the disease, whether with the uptake, sir.
Most of the time it is used when you have used it in the baseline also. You need to have a baseline of PET scan, what was the uptake, so that you can compare the uptake, because the subtle difference in lymph nodes especially, the element of inflammation can be very, very confusing, right? And the tuberculosis would be discussed at length in a generalized lymphadenopathy, although you defended your lymphoma pretty well. Any question, anybody? Yeah.
Fertility preservation and...
That's an important point. When they go for... most of them would have an element of infertility following this, because chemotherapy acts on rapidly multiplying cells wherever they are. And also, some of them would require radiation. When do they require radiation?
Sir, in stage 1 and stage 2 disease, after giving 2 cycles of chemotherapy, if there is a remnant disease...
Remnant. So answer is remnant or recurrent disease. Otherwise, you don't normally, upfront, you don't give it.
Upfront.
Very well. Sorry?
Tubercular lymphadenopathy, its first stage is a stage of lymphadenitis. Second stage is a case of is the stage of periadenitis, when we will find the mattening of the lymph nodes. Third is the stage of... collapses. Then fourth is cholestatic abscess, where it erodes through the deep fascia. And for fifth is the stage of sinus formation.
Good. What is scrofula?
Scrofula is, previously it was used for cervical tubercular lymphadenopathy.
It's the same thing.
Yeah.
Cholestatic.
Cholestatic.
What is cholestatic abscess?
Cholestatic abscess is a bilobar abscess where after the formation after the caseation of the lymph node, after the formation of the cold abscess, the pus erodes through the deep fascia and it
lies under the skin like a collar stud. Right? And it was also called King's Evil. Because they felt in 1930s and 40s there were a lot of huge amount of tuberculosis in UK, and they were all dying of it. So they would call to visit the king, King Henry, where we would touch them and give them a guinea so that their nutrition is taken care of. It was believed the touch of kings healed their disease, which was actually nutrition when they was giving a guinea. So it's called King's Evil, scrofula or cholestatic abscess. And cholestatic is in the cervical region mostly. It can be anywhere else also. I think well presented. Give her a big round of applause. And any tubercular abscess, aspiration is anti-gravity. Can you tell us why, Priyanka?